to Speechless. Glad to have you here, live from the SCC studios in White Bear Lake, also playing live over SPNN in St. Paul. And if you're seeing this at any other time besides May 26th, don't call in. But since it is May 26th, you're watching this live. If you got comments or questions, call in 651-747-3838. Or if you don't want to call in but make comments, and I appreciate the people who seem to be getting a lot more comments lately, speechlessmn@gmail.com. And if you want to watch past shows, youtube.com/speechlessmn. A couple interesting things. We're going to talk about all things judiciary today, justice, because it's, you know, election time's around the corner here, and all the candidates for all offices have to announce by May 31st. They have to tell the Secretary of State, I'm running for office, and fill out their forms and do that. If they don't, you can't run. That's just the way it works, unless there's just some weird circumstances that somebody dies and in a high position seat and they need to fill it. So we got elections coming up, and particularly I've been looking at the, well, you know, before we're going to talk about on the show, but before we get into that, today's my birthday, turned a big 58. I know it's hard to believe I'm that old. I know I don't look that old, but that's, you know, that's just the way it goes. I had nothing to do with it. But when I woke up this morning, this overwhelming thought was on my mind, and it was, so I want to share that with you, and I want to thank everybody on Facebook. You get a lot of birthday wishes on Facebook, and I got a lot of them today, and this was what was on my mind when I woke up. Part of this section out of Psalm 34. But then I read all of Psalm 34. And yeah, that's pretty good. That's a good one to start the new year out with, and to remind ourselves what's really important. It says, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, and he answered me, and delivered me from all my fears. Those who look to him are radiant, and their faces shall never be ashamed. This poor man cried, and the Lord heard him, and saved him out of all his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him, and delivers them. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. And that was the thought. Taste and see that the Lord is good. That was what was one of the thoughts that was coming this morning. Oh, fear the Lord, you his saints, for those who fear him have no lack. The young lion suffers want and hunger, but those who seek the Lord lack no good thing. Come, O children, listen to me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. What man is there who desires life and loves many days, that he may see good? Keep your tongue from evil and your lips from speaking deceit. Turn away from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. The eyes of the Lord are toward the righteous, and his ears toward their cry. The face of the Lord is against those who do evil, to cut off the memory of them from the earth. When the righteous cry for help, the Lord hears. He delivers them out of their troubles. The Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves the crushed in spirit. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them all. He keeps all his bones. Not one of them is broken. Affliction will slay the wicked, and those who hate the righteous will be condemned. The Lord redeems the life of his servants. None of those who take refuge in him will be condemned. So that's what I woke up today with for my birthday. It's a good way to start out the year. Good reminder that the Lord takes care of his own, particularly through death. And that's a big thing to understand. And Ah, there's so much to that Psalms there. That's good. Take it, read it for yourself. But it's been a great day. Moved two families, and the families were in good spirits, and we're all in good spirits, and that's always fun. And then now I get to do the show. So, and thanks for all the birthday wishes that came in. Maybe I'll cut this clip and send it out over Facebook so everybody can hear my thanks. All right, let's get into some meaty issues, judicial elections. What I want to do is kind of give you a rundown of what is important to think about and what is some of the history in relating to our judicial elections and why we have them. Why has the Republican Party been trying to endorse judges, people running for judge or justice, and why is that of any importance at all? So you have to come back to this understanding of who we are as a state, what we've been through, and what happened. You know, we all know the U.S. justice system, right? Federal district courts, federal appellate courts, U.S. Supreme Court. That's the order from bottom up. And, of course, the district courts do all the trying of fact and everything, just like we do here in Minnesota, very similar situation. Except the judges and justices in the federal courts, they're appointed. And their appointment comes from the President of the United States. And the President of the United States makes the appointment, but then the Senate, not the House of Representatives, U.S. House of Representatives, the U.S. Senate does a check and balance on that appointment and says, boy, are these persons qualified or not? And of course, we've seen the Justice Thomas, Kagan, you know, all these judicial appointments, the Bork, we've seen all these different governmental process take place, and people call that politics. It's governmental process. Politics is a word that's used to get people not to engage, to discourage people from engaging. But it's really the governmental process that's taking place, and parts of it you like, parts of it you don't. Just like any job or any part of life, there's things you have to do that you don't like. So that's our U.S. system. President appoints, Senate confirms. And then the individual who was appointed, they get their seat or they don't. Well, something happened about the time the state of Minnesota was formed, and it was called the Dred Scott decision. And that was where a free man, a black man in Minnesota, was forced back into slavery in Missouri, and the people of Minnesota were upset. And so, you know, a couple years later, the state of Minnesota was formed, and they said, hey, we got to do something different than the U.S. system. There's a problem with the checks and balances going on at the federal level. It's not being done. Now, the U.S. House can impeach judges, but they really can't impeach them for making bad decisions. They can impeach them for bad character, like they have done, once every 2 years, it seems that they're impeaching a judge. Kickbacks, sexual abuse, taking young men who are juveniles and then sodomizing them, and then having these juveniles having their sentences reduced or young men or whatever, pretty bad stuff. So they do have this checks and balances, but something was happening when the Dred Scott decision took place that people realized, no, we can't let a federal judge or a state judge, we don't want to have our judges have appointments for life. We want to have a bigger check and balance on our judiciary in the state of Minnesota. So they put in the impeachment process for the House to impeach and the Senate to try a justice just or a judge, just like in the federal courts. But then they added another layer, which was judicial elections. And that was to get rid of judges or justices that were making very, very poor decisions. And we see that today. And the poor decisions that I would think about that's happening today is just judges overreacting in these family law cases and just tearing and contributing to these families being torn apart when they don't have to go to the extremes that they're going to, and putting children and parents in very precarious situations that they just don't need to be in. Why do that? Why? And you look at these judges and they're just kind of vindictive and angry and mean, and I mean, it's almost like something's wrong with them. I mean, you got to go to court and see how some of these judges behave. It's atrocious. There are good judges, believe me. There are judges with very good behavior. But the law is written in such a way that they can do the right thing and that they can rule in a certain way that everybody benefits rather than one person being severely harmed, or both people being harmed, severely harmed or harmed. It's just really bad in our family law. And I just heard on the news today, San Diego just had a big exposure of judicial corruption taking place that is finally coming out in the family law arena, and it's basically relating to the finances of the family law. I'll follow up more on that next week. I didn't have time to dig in that deeper, but this whole family law scheme that's working in Minnesota and many other states, it's a big problem. And because of the financial way the child support and the system works, there's a lot of financial incentives for a lot of people to make sure families are destroyed and torn apart. I mean, families contribute enough to that, but you know, they help out enough. But a good judge can temper that and do it well. Not like David Knutson, who, I don't know what happened to him. He went off the deep end in the Grazzini-Rocky case. So again, in our past history, Minnesota says, okay, we're gonna elect judges. Okay, as another form of checks and balances. What they didn't put in is a Senate confirmation. And so later on, our Constitution was changed so that in the election process, I don't know exactly when this happened, but in case a judge resigned or retired or died or had some disability, then the governor could appoint a replacement within a certain time frame, and then that seat wouldn't be open for election except, you know, a year or 2 years down the road, then it would be open for election. And that justice sitting there by state statute would be able to get the word incumbent behind their name. Well, instead of having this big election process and an open, transparent election process, the legal field saw a way through court orders and through statutes to go and really abuse the system so that now you don't have this check and balance. You don't have an open, transparent system. You have a system that makes it so hard for somebody to run against a job, they're really not wise to do that, to spend their time, money, and effort. And, you know, I talk to people interested in running for judge, you know, and I ask them, are you prepared for your practice to suffer? You know, that you might start losing cases. And to a person, they realize that that is a possibility and a probability that that might start taking place. And so with the word incumbent behind the name, that just gives somebody a heads up. You know, I hear people say, boy, they talk about the incumbent behind the name. And, you know, today with the anti-incumbency movement, that's a detriment to a justice or a judge running for office. And my point is, well, it shouldn't be a benefit and it shouldn't be a detriment. It just shouldn't be on the ballot. You shouldn't have it on there if it's going to hurt a judge or justice. Why have that? Why have it so it shows somebody one way or the other? So just get rid of it. If you think it's a disadvantage, we should get rid of it. If you think it's an advantage, we should get rid of it. It should just be the justice name. That will open up transparency in the judicial system. More people will run against a judge or a justice. And just if to clarify the difference between a judge and a judge is at the district and appellate court, a justice is at the Supreme Court. I don't know that history as to why the distinction. But if you you see these people running for the elections and they go, well, one, they're not there. If you see an open seat, wow, a lot of people will start throwing their names in. And then if you see the rest are uncontested. And once in a while, you will see somebody run against a sitting judge. Now, what happens in that situation typically is that the other judges have gotten together and said, boy, this is really a bad judge. We need to run somebody against that judge in order to get them out. So your practice, your legal practice or law practice may not suffer because you got permission from the other judges to run against that person. But you will find other people who will run it, and I've been told that scenario. They said, hey, other judges came to me and said, hey, let's find somebody, you know, to run against this judge. They're really bad. Okay, I'm telling you things I've heard. You know, whether that's the reality or not from the people that have told me, you know, I don't know, but why would they tell me? You know, sure, could they be lying to me? I've had too many people say it. You know, and remember in Washington County where there are 17 judges running, or 17 attorneys running for the one open judge seat? Maybe there's 24. No, there's 24 people running for that seat. I talked to, you know, half dozen to a dozen of them, and every one of them said, I said, hey, look, you have 17 unchallenged judges. There you got a 50-50 chance of winning. It's a one-on-one, mano-on-mano here, and here you want to take on 24 people. You know, aren't your odds better? You know, and to a person they said, no. It doesn't matter about the odds because that odd of beating the incumbent is a lot higher than running against 24 other people and coming down to a primary situation. And then coming to a general election where you go one-on-one with the two top vote-getters. So that's the kind of the psyche of the judiciary that's going on out there and people running for it. I'd rather not run against the title incumbent. Okay, so the judiciary then has kind of overcome this check and balance of the election by using the word incumbent, by putting political pressure on people who run against a sitting judge. And then, well, there's a lot more other things they're asking these judges to do. They're saying, hey, please don't sign this form that says you won't get involved with a political party endorsing you. And this is your moral responsibility. That sign this that says you won't do that. So you see this. Here's what I call it. It's a cult-like influence in our judiciary. It's a black robe, diseased a body organism that abuses people, is the bottom word. They're abusive. And we'll get into that a little bit. But let's go back a little bit. So we had the Dred Scott decision. We've had basically no judges being impeached. Some have had criminal charges filed against them. The legislature hasn't even looked. The House of Representatives hasn't even looked at hearings to hear what's going on with the judiciary, hear the complaints. The House had an ad hoc hearing, which we've showed on this show. You can look on Speechless on the YouTube channel here and go watch those ad hoc hearings where people were complaining and then also giving answers as to things that would make the judiciary better. The Senate had some hearings on some bills for accountability, like taking away the word incumbent. But again, that was not it was not a votable hearing. It was in between the legislative sessions. So they can all do their grandstanding and make their big speeches, but they don't have to do anything about it. And then they just ignore it when the regular session comes up. But a lot of that is because there's lawyers in the legislature, which I think there shouldn't be, because that's a separation of powers. A lawyer in the legislature is part of the court. They're part of the court system. The Supreme Court has their license in their hand. And of course, judges or attorneys cannot make any despairing comments about the court system. It's against the rules. Okay, so you're in the legislature. How do you say something bad about the judiciary without the potential of being held accountable for it? I don't think you can do it. You're taking a big risk in that process. So let's go back here about party endorsement. Dred Scott. Nobody's being impeached. Legislature's not doing anything about it. Don't want to really hear complaints about what's going on in judiciary. It's a big learning curve for most representatives and senators. And then all of a sudden, the Minnesota Supreme Court makes a decision. The U.S. Supreme Court made a bad decision. Now the Minnesota Supreme Court makes a bad decision. That decision was Doe versus Gomez. I think it was Doe versus Gomez. I don't remember. Or Gomez versus, or some taxpayer versus Gomez. And what happened is basically someone said, hey, this funding of abortion is so against my religious beliefs that the state forcing me to pay for abortion is against my constitutional rights. And the Supreme Court ruled that you don't have freedom of religion in Minnesota to the extent that you have to pay for an abortion. your money has to go through that. It's going into the general tax fund. So since it's in the general tax fund and the legislature decides to spend this, who cares about your religious rights and religious freedoms? We're going to force you to do the unconscionable and pay for abortions. And what happened there then is that got some conservative Republican people pretty upset. And so they said, boy, we got to look at what's going on in our judiciary, and we have to fight back against these terrible decisions, which still is in effect today, this Gomez decision. Which, by the way, I happened to meet that lady because she was involved in the, she was part of the Health and Human Services program. And I was talking to her about, I don't remember what the, why the meeting happened, but I was talking about parental rights and fathers having constitutional rights to their kids and stuff like that. And then somebody else connected the dots to me to who this was. Actually, she did. She said, I'm the, you know, the Gomez in this case. And it was just kind of like right then and there I go, oh my goodness, you know, I'm wasting my time. This person cares nothing about fatherhood or fathers, or she wants me to pay for other fathers not having their kids. You know, what does she care whether I'm a father? You know, and it's just, it was just weird, you know, a weird experience. And you think that our state government is for families, and they're not. That's the bottom line. They have parens patriae. The parent is the state, okay? And so they can come in and they can make up a whole lot of reasons to take your children from you. And of course, you want two fastest ways to lose your liberties: get married, have children, and drive a car. Two fastest ways. They can get you so many ways coming and going. It's just unbelievable. So with this Gomez case and the taxpayers, a number of people in the Republican Party got together and said, "Hey, we got to do something about this. You know, we need to start endorsing judges." Now, remember, at this time we had 16 years of Perpich, DFL governor. We had, who's after Perpich? Was it Ventura, Carlson, Ventura, until we got to Plenty, as far as a Republican goes. We're in a situation where, because judges really aren't elected, they're only appointed, all these judicial seats were going to Democrats. And if you look at the state, we're really about almost 50-50 split. And there's some area of our state that's very strongly Republican, but they couldn't get any Republicans in there as judges. And so our state should be about a 50-50 split on the justices. Well, it's not. It was heavily DFL. And so the Republicans said, hey, let's start endorsing judges. Let's get people to run for judge. We can start getting conservative justices that follow the Constitution, understand the importance of family, and get these people in these spots so that then, you know, we can have some Supreme Court justices and people with experience in the judiciary. And so the Republican Party started endorsing judges. Well, that created a big brouhaha. I mean, that just, you know, the judiciary went wild. Oh, that's so unethical. We can't taint ourselves. We have to be impartial. Well, impartial to what? The Constitution, or impartial to your own personal beliefs? So, and there's something you have to understand and know very, very, very well. judges get to make whatever decision they want. Okay? A district court judge can make whatever decision they want. They only have to give a pretense of following the law. They don't have to follow it. They can do whatever they want, but they will give a pretense that they were following the law, and what they did, they had every right to do. And then it's up to you to go and appeal that decision, where you have three other judges in the appellate courts that, guess what? They get to do whatever they want too. They just have to give a pretense. And then, if you don't like that decision, you can go to the Supreme Court. And guess what? They get to make whatever decision they want. They only have to give a pretense in a legal definition. That's how it works. If you think you're going into the courtroom and you're going to get somebody to follow the law, no. They don't have to do that. That's just, and they'll all tell you that. I mean, they say it all the time, but you have to be able to hear it. And so that's why the issue of conservative versus liberal, look at the U.S. Supreme Court. It's always about the pretense of the law and who's in there that's going to vote the right way. That's what this election is coming up to. Who's going to be the Supreme Court justice? Is it going to be a conservative or is it going to be a liberal? Why? Because they can give a pretense. They can pretend that they're following the law and all they need to have is a majority, a 5-4 majority. All right, we got a phone call here. Caller, you have a comment or question? Thanks for calling.
I have a comment.
Okay.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. You look like, born in Israel, you look like a monkey and smell like one too.
All right. All right, well.
I shouldn't take it on the road, you think?
Well, you just did. Well, actually, take it on the freeway out at Highway 36, you know, right in the middle lane there. Take it out there.
Hey, I was out to Withrow. And Matt Dean called a seminar with Roger Chamberlain, Karen
right.
Mosley, and Kathy Lohmer talking about the Stillwater school shutdown.
Right.
And one of the positive suggestions that came out of that is one of the recipients said, hey, wait a minute, we should have a recall for school board members that don't follow through because they're charging them with fraud because, you know, they passed
right.
a referendum for $92.5 million, and then 3 months later they said, well, hey, we're changing the program. We're not going to do what we said the referendum was for. So
right.
I have some film footage of that, and I'm going to share it with Bob Zick. And if you want
Good.
It for next week, I'll give it to you, too.
Yeah.
But it was very interesting.
Well, it sounds like a very interesting meeting, and we'll want to play some of those clips, definitely. But it's a big problem, and very similar to the courts. I'm going to follow the Constitution. I'm going to swear an oath to the Constitution, but then you don't.
Well, you know, Tina Loban swears at the city council meetings all the time.
That's a different oath, but...
Okay.
All right.
Hey, keep
Thanks.
Up the good work, sir.
All right. Thank you. Got some good friends. All right. This pretense on the judiciary is a big deal, okay? So the Republican Party started endorsing, and they endorsed Greg Wersel to run for the Minnesota Supreme Court, and they endorsed other justices to run for the Minnesota Supreme Court. We got another phone call here, so I'm going to go to that phone call. And so, caller, do you have a comment or question?
I have a question.
Sure. Hey.
I believe that I saw recently that some district judges were trying to get the DFL endorsement in Hennepin County. Are you aware of that?
I am not aware of that. Where did you hear that?
I thought I saw it on some ad or something or something. And I was just curious if you had heard about that or were aware of any of that.
I am not. I know that right now the DFL does not endorse as a party. What they do do, how they do endorse is they will put all the city council, all the mayors, all the state representatives and senators, they'll put all their names on the judges or the justices' website as supporting this individual. So if you go and look at it, you go, oh, okay, this judge is full DFL.
I don't know. It was just that I saw, and I thought maybe you had heard of something or not. I thought I'd ask.
Yeah, no. But if I was in Hennepin County and I was a judge or wanting to be a judge, I'd certainly be going there.
All right. Thanks very much.
All right. Thank you. Which, you know, goes to the point of, you know, if you live in the 6th Congressional District or you're more into Washington County and or Anoka County or some of the conservative areas, Wright County, you know, if you're running for judge, you'd want the Republican Party endorsement because you would win. But the Judiciary Ethics Committee, the Supreme Court, holds a low view of these people that do that and will find a way to punish them if they can. So the Supreme Court, Greg Wursel gets this endorsement, and Greg Wursel goes out and raises money. And the Ethics Board, Lawyers Professional Responsibility Board, then files a complaint against Greg Wursel for raising money and getting endorsements. They say that's unethical. Of course, the whole concept that our judiciary does not allow for free speech, don't allow for cameras in the district courtroom, just now or, you know, they've done the Supreme Court room, you can go and ask for the appellate courts, but district courts you can now ask, but you're not likely to get in. Why it isn't an automatic, you know, why our courts don't get this, why our judges don't have to sign an oath of office where every other executive branch or legislative branch, you have to sign an oath of office. Judiciary, you don't have to do that. Minnesota Supreme Court ruled on that. It's amazing. So that's why I say our judicial branch in Minnesota has turned into a cult. And they have these cult-like members that will do everything to protect the judiciary, not from being independent, but being dependent on itself and a self-fulfilling, self-feeding group that gains more and more power. It's this monstrous beast that just keeps absorbing any power it can get. And they cannot have anybody say anything bad about the judiciary. It doesn't matter whether a judge violates your religious freedoms. It doesn't matter where they take away or they violate your parental rights and tell you how to live every aspect of your life. You know, they just have this overwhelming power that is being unchecked. And believe me, it would not take much to get them back in line. All the legislature needs to do is file, impeach about 3 judges. They could do it very easily. You can draw 3 names out of a hat and you can probably find a judge that would be impeachable. You know, so with this endorsement process, they go after Greg Wursel, exercising his freedom of speech, exercising his right to raise money for a campaign. Greg Wursel loses all the way to the Minnesota Supreme Court, but wins there. I mean, he didn't get one vote in his favor all the way, but he wins at the Supreme Court 5-4. You understand what I've been saying? It's a pretense, and the final vote is the winner. But in this case, they got it right because we do have a constitution and five justices feigned that it actually means something. And actually, I think the five justices, except Justice O'Connor, who was sorry she made the decision, the other four believed it. But the four that voted against it made up a whole rationale that was wholly outside of the U.S. Constitution of freedom of speech and freedom of assembly, freedom of association. So, Minnesota judiciary attacked Greg Wurzel, and he won. Okay, and so now he gets to go out and raise money. Now he gets to get endorsements, and so do every other judge or justice. And then along comes new rules for behavior of the justice, and they said, "Oh, but if you do run for judge, you can't have." You can only ask for money if there's more than 20 people in the room. So Greg Wurzel's famous joke, well, that means if I want to ask for money from my wife, I have to get 19 other people into my lawyers into my bedroom, you know, to ask her for a donation for my campaign. You know, it's ridiculous. There's other ways to deal with this freedom than putting on erroneous restrictions, and that means the small law firms don't get to hear these candidates come and speak. The candidates have to spend their time at the big law firms where there's 20 or more people. It's just, this is the game that goes on. This is the hidden game inside the judiciary that people don't know about. So, inside the Republican Party, though, even though they are for endorsement, there are people who don't want to endorse for the judiciary. Most of them are attorneys. Most of them get favors, and in my opinion, are trying to earn favors from the judiciary, hoping to be assigned a judge in the future because they don't want endorsement. So last election cycle, we've had a number of good people run for justice and got endorsed. Greg Wurzel, Tim Tinglestad, Dan Griffith, super people. Yet this one guy named Harry Niska, an attorney, he gets up and doesn't want any of them endorsed. So the party decides, hey, we're not going to endorse. We're just not going to put any names up for endorsement. And so now when you come to Michelle McDonald being endorsed 2 years, the party said, hey, you know, the party educated itself. Oh, wait, something's wrong here. So people started asking questions. You know, once you, as a party, you say, okay, we're not going to endorse, then you got to start going, oh, wait a second. That was stupid. Now we are people with our values and views, don't know who to vote for. And these people can't campaign on that, and we won't have these people in judicial office. And so people realize, oh, we need to endorse. So 2 years ago, they endorsed Michelle McDonald. The committee met with her, vetted her. I'm on that committee. She knows the law. And this issue of her drunk driving came up, but we vetted that whole thing left and right. We saw the videos. I went through them. I knew what they were about. It was very clear to me she wasn't drunk driving, you know, and the officers were acting outside the law. They even said so on the stand, that they were acting outside the law. He used different words. But there was a big brouhaha because there are some people that say the accusation is the crime. If you get accused, then you're guilty. And you know, that's just the way it is. That's part of the deal. Okay. So with the endorsement, then a whole big brouhaha took place in the Republican Party. And it really came from the executive committee and the administration. It did not come from the rank and file to the extent that people think. It came from the administration, and they started playing games. They started saying, oh boy, Michelle McDonald, she's going to be at the state fair. You know, well, that's where candidates go. And so they excluded her from all activities within the Republican Party. So this was their mess that they were making. They were making these things public. All they had to do is leave it alone, let the people decide. But right now, the Republican Party isn't about letting people decide things. It's about manipulating things and telling untruths so that you get this top-down approach. And I was at the Republican State Convention. The Republican Party went real heavy to top-down. Republican Party used to be and was known as more of a grassroots party. Not anymore. It went heavy top-down. Okay. Big time. And the people didn't get it. They didn't see it. They didn't see what was taking place there. So what then happened with McDonald, they say, hey, don't go to the state fair booth, because, and they didn't tell her until she was in the state fair booth. You can't be here. They already had a bouncer hired. And the reason they gave is because she said she would be there every day. That was the reason. And we have other candidates, and we don't want her taking away attention from the other candidates. That was their stated reason. However, other candidates were there every day. Sharna Walgren, who was running for the 4th congressional district seat, there every day, or almost every day, may have missed one or two. But that's not a problem. But then also came the threat over the phone from Patrick Burns, an attorney, acting on behalf of the Republican Party, at least he said he was. And he told Michelle McDonald, and we'll play this next week, had to find a clean copy, and he said, Michelle, you got till noon to write a letter for resignation, otherwise they're going to mess the Republican Party and the judiciary is going to mess your life over. Your kids, your husband's job, your career, it'll be all wrecked. And it's going to happen. And after you send the letter of resignation, then we will talk to you. Who would do that? I mean, who would do that talking afterwards? You know, so she said no. And then they came down on her really hard with the attorneys writing letters. And one was Senator Newman, who ran for attorney general, who got very low ratings for his election. And Michelle got very high as far as statewide races go for the Republican Party, highest percentage vote getting. Okay, so Michelle decides to run again for the Minnesota Supreme Court. So the Judicial Election Committee, you know, she came to it and we vetted her. We asked her questions. People, actually 2 years ago when she was vetted, she was asked a lot harder questions. And the head of the committee, Doug Seaton, said this, well, I find what you're saying about your case to be very troubling, if it's true. If it's true, it's troubling. But I don't believe that it's true. Well, the jury didn't agree with Seaton, and it's Doug Seaton, and the jury found that it was very true. So we vetted her again, and there was two attorneys put on this committee that were not elected. They were appointed. And one was David Asp, and the other one was Harry Niska, this guy, both of these guys that don't want judicial elections at all. And then they changed the rules. Typically, in the rules for the Republican Party, you had to have at least 30% to have a minority say to against the majority. And in this case, there was they changed the rules this year to have only two people to be in a minority, to produce a minority report. And that was, in this case, for the Judicial Elections Committee, it was David Asp and Harry Niska. And they were going to do whatever they could. Remember, they were trying to shoot down any justice in prior years. So Michelle McDonald, this was not about Michelle McDonald. This was about any justice or anybody running for court. They were going to shoot them down. So they came up with a minority report. The minority report said the JEC majority's decision to withhold important information from the convention regarding Michelle McDonald's qualification as a candidate. Well, we didn't. And one of the things that they said, well, we voted. Yeah, okay. Michelle McDonald sued the Republican Party. She sued Patrick Burns as an agent for the Republican Party, a guy that threatened her career, threatened her family, threatened her kids, threatened her husband's business, and said they're all going to be destroyed. They're going to come and, you know, get you. They're going to do some bad things to you that I don't know that you can handle. And you're going to have to hear that. And actually, you can go online and hear this in a number of different places. So the they said Michelle sued, and to me it's a so what? So what if you sue the Republican Party? Big deal. But to them it was like, well, you can't do that. And do you promise not to do that in the future? Well, being a smart person, Michelle said, I have no plans on suing the Republican Party, but I don't know what they're going to do. You know, that may be unethical, that may be illegal. You know, I don't know. I have no plans. And that just, oh, how can you do that? I mean, you know, and that was stated at the Republican Party as a reason. You know, well, every single person in that convention can sue the Republican Party. And every person there may not have any intention of doing it, but circumstances may require that you do it. But to go and make a promise that you're not going to do it, no person in their right mind would say that. And so the people asking the question are the people not in their right mind. But they're using it as a governmental process to injure somebody or to persuade people that, oh, they can't, you know. Again, it's this cult-like behavior that an organism or organization is the end-all and be-all. And individual rights, you know, throw them out the door. Okay. So they made a statement, and they really didn't make very many statements. They kind of restated, you know, one point three or four different times. So, and they talked about 2 years ago where it brought harm to the Republican Party. Well, the harm was caused by what the Republican Party did to Michelle McDonald. If it caused harm, it was what the party did. If they would have let her gone to the state fair booth, left her alone, no big deal. If they wouldn't have threatened her, no big deal. If they didn't treat her, if they would have let her had her campaign lists, the list of the delegates, no big deal. If they would have let her had the donor list, no big deal. But they didn't do all that. Okay, and that's what made the press, and that's what brought bigger attention to this issue than would have been brought. And then we go and find out, no, Michelle McDonald's wasn't drunk driving. her case of not taking the intoxilizer test is sitting now before the U.S. Supreme Court. Not her case specifically, but one very, very similar to it is sitting before the U.S. Supreme Court. Michelle McDonald's case, it has not timed out for her appeal to the Minnesota Supreme Court. But she's challenging the incorrectnesses, the bad behavior by people that are abusing their authority. And this was one of the issues that came up at the Republican Party, is that we asked the question, are you an originalist? Do you know what originalist or strict constructionist? She wrote down answers that had already been written down in hand. She had the answers. And these two attorneys says, well, it wasn't deep enough. It was more sound bites. And, well, we weren't asking for a thesis, you know. We were just asking, what's your judicial philosophy? And she answered it. And then they actually, in my opinion, misstated her position on it. And they definitely demeaned her in that process. But that they got to say to the convention. By the way, she filed a case based on original intent, dealing with press in the courtrooms. We're out of times. But anyway, that's why we have judicial endorsement in Minnesota and why we need to keep them. Remember, if you don't stand up for other people's liberties, who's going to stand up for yours? And good men don't do nothing. God bless. Have a great week. Bye-bye. Sets on fire.